You're watching the Spirit Food Christian Center Worldwide Webcast, broadcasting live every Sunday at 10 a.m. Pacific Time.
Yes, amen, hallelujah. When spirit food comes to you, blessings will flow. Say yes.
What the Bible says I possess. I am a believer, not a doubter. Therefore, God's word is working abundantly in my life with signs following. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so we're going to get in this word today. To be honest with you guys, I went to bed at like 4:30 this morning. But from like praise and worship and just being up here, glorifying God with you guys, I feel like I'm on 10. I want to start pop locking. So if I get a little silly, I would like to blame it on coffee or something, but that's just, I'm excited. So the title of my message today, the title of my message today is Childish, and I took the title. How many have ever seen the TV show Blackish? Okay, so Blackish is a TV show that just, it's a show where if you are black, I'm sorry, I didn't know how to say it, have witnessed a black family, is something you can relate to because they show the qualities and just, you know, the different activities that a black family does, a stereotypical black family does. So my title today is Childish, and the ish on the childish, it means to having the qualities or characteristics of. So now I know some of you may hear, like, you know, well, the scripture says, when I was a child, I thought like a child, but when you grew up, you threw away childish things, right? But I don't want to approach it from that standpoint today. I'm going to approach it from the submissive part. And it's funny, as I was thinking about this title, well, first, like, when I moved out here from Philly to L.A., God blessed me with a family. And I have an L.A. dad, I don't know where he went, L.A. mom, sisters, Roz, and four other little ones over there. So on Tuesday, it was Elon's birthday. So I called her and I said, hey, you know, what do you want? First she said, I want a Hershey's bar, and then, or a Hershey's candy, some kiss. And then she said, I said, okay, what else? And she said, a Segway. I said, what else? So then she says to me, I want $1,000. And we both laughed after she said it. But it was funny because just a couple months ago, she said she only wanted 50. So her growth and her desires are exponential. So when she said $1,000, I had a total appreciation for her boldness to ask me for that. Because as her sister, Roz knows also, like, they ask us for stuff and it's kind of like, what? Like, they don't know the other side of the coin. they just know what they want. But they believe us to provide it for them. And what I think is awesome. So, well, let me first give you the foundational scripture for today. Matthew 18. And if you see, my Bible is kind of tore up. I was going to bring my nice Bible, but I like this one. So, so turn to Matthew 18. Matthew 18, and we'll start at verse 1. Say amen when you're there. So it says, at the same time, the disciples unto Jesus saying, who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? Now the disciples were talking about a physical reign on heaven, like Jesus was going to come establish like a government type of system. But they didn't understand that Jesus is a spiritual guy. Like, he's not talking about necessarily the natural, but he's talking about the spiritual realm. So they said, who's going to be the greatest in the kingdom? And Jesus called a little one unto them, a little child unto him, and said in the midst of them, and he said, verily I say unto you, except ye be converted and become as little children, ye shall not enter the kingdom of heaven. Whosoever therefore shall humble himself as a little child, the same is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. So what does that say? That scripture is talking about having humility. So how I want to approach humility today is not necessarily from the aspect of, how can I say this? Well, basically, a synonym for humility is submission. And how I relate that to my story about Elan is, she understands her place in my life, that I, as a type of guardian over her, will give her anything that she desires if I have it available to her. So she accepts that position and she has submitted to it. So what I want to speak to you about today is seeing who you are, or not seeing, but knowing who you are in Christ and submitting yourself to that position. Okay, so let me see where I want to go. Okay, so he said that you have to humble yourself to enter into the kingdom of God. And what I thought was dope about that, if you're not saved, I want you to have your eyes and ears open to what is described today so that you can make a decision to Christ. And as you, all the rest of you that are saved, I want you to receive this and take yourself to a whole nother level of faith, okay? Because this was powerful when God showed it to me, but move forward. So again, you can't see the intimate God without submitting yourself under the rule of God, right? So let's turn to John 3. Now everybody is pretty much familiar with John 3:16. God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son. For whoever should believe in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. But I want to go back up to verse 1, John 3, verse 1, where there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. The same came to Jesus by night and said unto him, Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher, come from God, for no man can do these miracles that thou doest except God be with him. So I want to actually circle God be with him, and we're going to come back to that. And verse 3, Jesus answered and said unto him, Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. So when I read that before, I read it like I kind of glazed over it because I've already received Jesus, so I get it. But when I read it with new eyes, it says, unless a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. I'm born again, so what should I see? The kingdom of God, right? So how can we see the kingdom of God? Or, yeah, how can we see the kingdom of God? Well, we need to open our eyes. I want you to turn to 2 Kings 6:1. So we have the kingdom of God available for us to see. So we no longer have to look at the circumstances. We go to a word-based church, and so we know how to operate in faith. But like, I needed something deeper. I needed to experience God on another level than just having a confession and speaking it. I needed to visualize. I'm a visual person also, so I needed to visualize my situation. So when I read that, his word said, what did I just say? That when you're born again, you can see the kingdom of God. I said, okay, dope. I can see the kingdom of God. So, but let's have a reference. Let's have an Old Testament reference about seeing. So I said 2 Kings. Everybody there? Okay, I got to get there. Okay, 2 Kings, we're going to start at verse, oh, I'm sorry, 2 Kings 6. Okay, so I'm not going to read the whole thing because me and Kel split up time and I don't want to go over his. So basically, they were about the people were coming to get Elijah and all these people, and his servant said to him, he's like, yo, they coming for us, right? So Elijah, being a man of God, he is aware of what the kingdom provides. He knows what the kingdom is, but he said to his servant, well, he said he prayed for his servant. And so let's look at 15. And when the servant of the man of God was risen early and gone forth, behold, a host compassed the city, both with horses and chariots. And his servant said unto him, Alas, my master, how shall we do? And he answered, He answered, Fear not, for they that be with us are more than they that be with them. And Elijah prayed, and Elijah prayed and said, Lord, I pray thee, open his eyes that he may see. And the Lord opened the eyes of the young man, and he saw, and behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire round about Elijah. So that's how we're supposed to be as children of God. Like, we come across circumstances all the time. And I decided, God is so amazing. God is so dope. We sing a song up here, God made the mountains, God made this, God made that, and we should appreciate it, right? But I needed to experience it on another level. So when I was like, okay, I read that I could see the kingdom of God, God showed me. And so I found scriptural reference that said, open the eyes that he may see. So he opened my eyes to see. And when we see circumstances in life, right, you don't look at them through your natural eyes. I promise you, don't look at them from your natural eyes. Paint that picture with the word of God. Paint that picture with what you know and the love that you know God has for you, so that you can see what he says about the situation. Can't nobody hold us as Christians and believers when we know, when we're strong in what we stand in. about to get excited because, like, we really have the opportunity to see the kingdom of God. And when you hear that, like, you should be excited about it. Because if you can see the kingdom of God, what is in the kingdom of God? Is there lack? Is there sickness? There's no disease, right? No crime? No, I don't know, nothing bad, right? So if we are spiritually connected to the kingdom of God, we're in it, right? All we got to do is say, I'm a citizen of the kingdom of God. I pull forth the resource that is in this kingdom, and I speak into manifestation. I remember as I was preparing for this message, I was thinking about my mom, and how, like, I went to Catholic school. I always dressed nice. I had a beeper. you know, my hair stayed done. I was provided for, but she was like, we poor. And I was like, I ain't poor. But I couldn't understand how she could say that when every need we had was met. And, like, still to this day, well, actually not now because, well, not in the past couple months, I learned how to rely on God, and so I don't necessarily ask her for any money or whatever. But when I was under her household, I knew that I could go to her and call on her, and she would provide for me. So let's go to the scripture in Ephesians 2:11. Now, when I read this, it helped me. It helped me understand being a citizen of the kingdom of God and knowing that my every need is met, everything is supplied for me. I have every advantage in life because God is our Father, right? So let's go to Ephesians. Said Ephesians 2:11, correct? Okay. Everybody there? Okay, so, wherefore, remember that ye being in time past Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcised by that which is called the circumcision. Now, back in the day, the Israelites were related to God in the fact of cutting out their flesh, right? But now, we don't have to do that anymore. We allow our hearts to be cut, okay? So, Gentiles just mean that they didn't have their flesh circumcised or cut. Men didn't have their flesh. Women didn't have to do that. Anyway, so by which is called the circumcision in the flesh made by hand, that at the time ye were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenant of promises, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, ye who sometimes were far off were made nigh by the blood of Christ. For he is our peace, who has made both one and hath broken down the middle wall of perdition between us. Basically, all it's saying right there is we have Jesus now. we have Jesus now, and we have a connection with God. There's no more barrier between us and God. Okay, so having abolished in his flesh the enmity even the law of commandments contained in the ordinances, for to make in himself of twain one new man, so making peace, and that he might reconcile both unto God in one body by the cross, having slain the enmity thereby, and came and preached peace to you which were far off, and to them that were nigh. For through him we both have access by one Spirit unto the Father. Now therefore, ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God. So when I heard the household of God, I was like, my God, like, I was in the household of my mother, and I knew that everything was taken care of, even though she had limited resources just from a you know, her daily job or whatever, and she had to pay for everything I needed. But I am now in the household of God. Like, do you get that? You're now in the household of God. But the only way it will become a reality in your life is if you choose to open up your eyes and see it. Like, there are so many times we complain about something and we see the lack in a situation. Shut that down. Like, what is it going to benefit you to complain or to be worrying or brokenhearted about anything? Rejoice, because you know God already did it. You are in the house of God, and he said that I will supply your every need. Like, there should be more than 10 of y'all clapping. And I don't mean to say that as yelling, but, like, for real. Like, God said it's done. But all we got to do is walk in it. Like, you know when Pastor do that dance when he get happy? Like, I'm for real about to run around this place because God said it is done. So basically, I'm going to start wrapping it up. That's my message. To be like, Elon was bold enough to ask me for $1,000. Actually, it was funny. The apple doesn't fall from the tree, even though we're not blood related. A couple months ago, we were in corporate prayer. I saw Minister McBain. And I said, Minister McBain, how about giving me $1,500 for a computer? Now, I threw it out, figured to see if she catched it, but she didn't. She hit like the mixture, so she was like, whoa. She was not having it. Oh. I mean, but she did say, well, I need to hear from the Holy Spirit. But that was her way of like saying no. So. But, you know, I figured I have a 50-50 chance, right? Yes or no? You know, it's like one of those things I'm playing, unless you're going to do it. But, what was I saying? Oh, so, but she said no, and you know, I kept on going. Well, she didn't say no, but she said she waiting for the message. So, I proceeded to walk to my seat, and I had a moment with God that was so real that I will never forget, that took me to another level of faith. I said, you know what, God? I thank you for the manifestation of my computer right now in Jesus' name. So then I sit down, and I'm talking to somebody about my computer or whatever. And because it was old, so it didn't run as fast. And they turned to me and said, you want a new computer? And I'm like, what? That was no less than 5 minutes ago that I had called out the manifestation of what I wanted. Like, I read the Bible and it says, The man was healed in that same hour. The man was healed instantly. Why aren't we having those same reactions, or why are we not seeing those same blessings occur at this moment? Like, expect. That's all I'm saying. Be bold enough to expect that it's going to happen. Like, what do you have to lose? Being disappointed? Man, he's God. Like, dude, he's God. I don't know how else to say it in another way, but like, to break through whatever hardening you have on your heart, to understand who you serve. Like, we don't do this. We don't come together to serve God just to like do something. Like, we are growing. We're getting educated. We're getting equipped so that we can help a world out there that needs us. We have to get past our own needs and like, oh, I want this. Oh, man, just say, I got it. Like, be bold enough to say, I got it. Walk in it. Like, we're in the household of God. I don't want to fuss, but like, we're in the household of God, so you have it. And there's a world out there that needs to see what we have. But if we, you know, walking around, you know, all sad and stuff, why would they come to Christ? Think about that. Like, if they see you doing bad, you doing just as bad as they are. Like, so just to wrap my message up, when we really walk in and we receive and we have that childish behavior towards God and we accept the fact that we're in his kingdom and everything is met, what will the world, what will we look like to the world? So I want you to turn to Isaiah 60. Yes, Isaiah 60. 6-0, yes. 6-0. I'm sorry, my accent. Well, I apologize. Oh, okay. Write this. Okay. Oh, okay. I love y'all. Okay, so Isaiah 60 says, so again, I'm saying, what will the world see when we start believing and recognizing who we are in Christ? Arise and shine, for the light has come. When you walk into a room, you better walk bold. Like, you walk up in like the light is here. The kingdom of God is present. Where the kingdom of God is present. When you walk into a meeting, when you're trying to get somebody to help you, you don't walk in there trying to get them to help you. You walk in there because you a blessing to them. When you walk into your job, you a blessing. You have established the kingdom of God. For Jesus said in Mark 1:15, the kingdom of God is at hand. That is you. You are at hand wherever you go, wherever our feet tread. It's for the kingdom of God. That is yours, but you got to walk in that boldness. I remember I used to run track, and I ran a 4x1. And, you know, I won't say I'm cocky. I like to say aware. So I'm aware of the abilities that I had. So it was like the finals. Not the finals, but the quarterfinals, or we had to qualify or whatever. So I remember going up to the line. Now, I had done bad that year. I just wasn't practicing, whatever. But I had got on my grind because my coach had kicked me off the team. Yeah, that was my ego. It was like, what, me? So he kicked me off the team, so I did what I had to do. So it was time to run. Now, I knew I was doing everything that I needed to do. So I walk up to the I ran the second leg, so I walk up to the line, and this nice girl was like, oh, everybody, you know, have a good time. I'm sitting there like, I'm about to smoke all y'all. And I know that wasn't humble, but I'm just saying, I came aware. I came to know what my purpose there. It wasn't to have a good time. It was to win. Like, it was to win, and that's what I was going to do. And I wasn't just going to win, but I was going to win. I was going to went to a point where I put my teammates in a better position. So my the girl came, and I grabbed the stick, and it was like tunnel vision. I was like, shoo, shoo, shoo. And so we were on a stagger, right? So I'm on the inside lane, so you know it's the far back. And so a girl was all the way up there because she had the higher stagger. My goal was like, I'm going to catch her. So I'm just like, whoo. And I heard my teammates, whoop, whoop. Like, that's how the noise they make when you're about to suck somebody up. So I was out, and I caught it. It was such a blessing to see my teammate almost one-third of the race done while the other girls were still getting the baton. So I came because I knew my purpose was to win. So when you walk into a situation, your purpose is to do what?
Win.
Your purpose is to do what?
Win.
Praise the Lord. So again, just to wrap it up, Approach God like Elon did. Ask for that $1,000. You know, what is going to hurt you? But, like, really, be childlike, be humble, understand that who you have submitted yourself under, and how he has taken care of everything, and rejoice. Like, the word says, I know I said I was wrapping it up, but the word says, get it from my pastor dad. So, the word says, rejoice when you fall into trials. Why? Because you're about to see God do his thing. Like, oh, man, like, for real. Like, I've seen some things where I'm just like, I could trip about this, but I'm not, because God about to do it, and then I'm going to have a testimony that's going to free somebody else. Like, this world ain't just about us. It's about who we can free. I got to go. All right, so I thank y'all for the time and opportunity to speak. Oh, no. This is the Holy Spirit. I got to bring up my brother. Now, Kel got a message for y'all. The Holy Spirit through him, man. Like, y'all better leave here about it. I don't know what else to say, but.
Man, y'all give it up for Anisha. She went in. Come on, Anisha. That was a good word. How many of y'all ready to win? Amen, amen. Okay. I'm speaking on the topic, when you run alone, it's called a race. But when you run with God, it's called grace. I'm gonna say that one more time. When you run alone, it's called a race. But when you run with God, it's called grace. See, in the Bible, the word race is used many times to describe everyday life. You know, for one example, in Hebrews 12:1, which is my foundational text, Hebrews 12:1, you can turn there for me. Let me know when you're there. And for this, I would like to use the New Living Translation. Yay! Shout out to the New Living Translation. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, let us strip off every weight that slows us down, especially the sin that so easily trips us up, and let us run with endurance the race God has set before us. Now, how many of y'all seen a race before? You seen a race? You seen track and field? You know, I know Anisha was talking about racing, so she's been running before. She knows about that. And those runners are physically fit, right? Takes a lot to run. Takes endurance. It takes strength. You got to work out. Now, you know, when people want to win a race or they want a race, they just sit there talking about, oh, yeah, man, I want to win a race. I want to get out there and run. But they sitting on the couch eating Cheetos, just chilling. You can't run if you're not going to get up and do something about it. Okay, so like if you want to run, right, you want to be a runner, what's the first thing you got to do? Come on now, what you got to do? You got to run. You got to take that first step. You got to warm up, right? See, that's why I'm wearing my track suit, see? Because you got to run. You got to get out there and do it, right? Because that's why in Nike they say, y'all smart. Just do it. Just do it. You got to get out there and just do it. You can't sit on the couch talking about I want to win a race. You got to go out there and try it. Try something. Now let's take that same scenario and let's make it spiritual. All right? So instead of race, we're going to replace race with life. Okay? So that same person sitting there eating Cheetos. I just want to win at life. I just want to be successful. I just want to win at life. It's the same thing. How do you win at life? Anybody know? Yeah? Okay, there's one thing you got to do first, though. You got to give your life to Christ. That's what you got to do. Got to give your life to Christ. You got to confess he is Lord and Savior. You got to. You got to do it. And once you give your life to Christ, then everything will start changing around. But you got to do it. You got to get up there. You got to believe it in your heart. Because see, if you're running and you were talking about you were going to run and you start running, people start saying, oh, no, Rodney, he believed he was going to run. And he running. He running everywhere. He's in track. He's doing his thing. They gonna say the same thing about you. He believed that Jesus died for his sins and rose again. So he's in the church. He's doing what he's supposed to do. But when you tell people that, when you tell them, hey, you need to give your life to Christ, they be like, yeah, man, I'm gonna wait till I get older. I'm out here in these streets, man. I'm trying to get this money, right? You trying to get this money. Your car don't work. Living with your mama. And then for the brothers that do got money, they selling drugs, so they watching their back. Every minute, you not really happy. You got to really give your life to Christ and really do it. You know? Now, when a runner says, I've been running every day, you know, I'm out here getting it. I'm getting faster. you know, my legs are getting stronger. I'm breaking down my muscles, and that's how you grow your muscles. You got to break them down, see how far you can go, right? So you're doing that, you're getting better. Then all of a sudden you say, you know what? I want to join a race. I want to get in a race. It's time. Now what you do is that you start getting a coach. You need a coach to help you through it, help you know what to do, right? And they're going to train you and get you ready for a race. Then you join a team, you know, like, for instance, team track and field, UCLA, you know, USC, or if it's the Olympics, team Jamaica, team USA, right? So now you got your jacket. You got your team jacket and you're ready to race. Now, you could do the same thing with Christians, right? The same exact thing. So you go back to Hebrews, right? That's where you go. You go back to Hebrews. You got it up there? Right? Now, when you're in the church and you give your life to Christ and you're trying to take it seriously, what happened is that you start getting coaches that see the spirit inside of you that want to help you out the same way. So you're sitting there and you got your kingdom jacket on now. And you're ready to run. And you're ready to get into this race. Now, what did it say? It says, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith. Witnesses to the life of faith. So we have a lot of witnesses to the life of faith right here in this church. Got Pastor, got Minister Me Bain. They're all in here. They all have stories of faith. But you got to be ready. You got to be in here. You got to be ready to train. You got to get into the word and get into the church and get ready to learn. But when you do that, though, there's some things you got to let go. A lot of people don't want to let go certain things when that happens, you know. Well, if you keep reading on in that, in Hebrews, it says, let us strip off every weight that slows us down, especially the sin that so easily trips us up. You got to let it go. Got to let it go. Those certain friends that you hang around trying to get you to do certain things that you know not's right, got to let them go. You know, you sitting there watching certain things on the computer that you should not be watching, knowing if your mama came in. Gotta give it up. Gotta give it up. And let us run with endurance the race God has set before us. And you might say, well, okay, Kel, well then, how am I gonna do that? You know, the world is crazy. It's a lot of things that I'm involved in. You want me to run this race. You're saying life is a race. How do I do it? Well, you keep on reading. Y'all got it there in front of you? You got it? What'd it say? We do this by keeping our eyes on Jesus. On Jesus. The champion who initiates and perfects our faith. So if you're trying to win a race, Jesus is already the champion. And if the champion is inside of us and he's in our heart, then that means we're champions. Everybody say, I'm a champion.
I'm a champion.
I'm ready to win.
I'm ready to win.
See, but when you do that, it takes faith. See, it takes faith to run. It takes a lot of faith because you haven't won yet. You know, you've seen all these other people next to you and they looking crazy. They ready. You know, they ready. And you see it. You see the finish line. You're like, man, I want to make that finish line. So you stretching. You trying to get it ready. Right. But you got to have faith. You got to have faith and let go of certain things in your life. You can't be thinking about unforgiveness and jealousy, because all those things will weigh you down and you're not going to be able to run. So you got to let it go and be happy. Let go of that sin. Now, changing your life takes a lot. Takes a lot. I mean, every time I got in trouble or I messed up, it's because I took my eyes off Jesus, right? Every time. And I know that now. Now, you have to say to yourself, enough is enough, and I want to win at life. So I got serious. I started changing my life around, started putting my eye on Jesus. Now, let me do this. Let me role play real quick with y'all. I want to role play. I want to show you how how it is running a race with Jesus. Hogan, you up in here? Oh, come here, man. Come here. Make some noise for Hogan. Hogan. You're like, what are we doing, Kel? I don't know.
Ready.
Love you, brother. Marced, are you in the building? Marced? Okay, you got a big brother. Okay, come on, Ron. Come on, that Ron raised his hand. I want to participate. Make some noise for Ron. Come on down, Ron. Hey. Okay, Ron, this is what we're going to do. You're going to come over here, right? I want you to get by this door right here. And I just want you to stand by the door. Don't do nothing. Just stand right here by the door, okay? Don't do nothing. Just stand there, okay? Now, this is Hogan, right? And he's running in the race of life right now, right? We're going to start from over there. The finish line is right through that door, through the double doors. That's where the finish line is. That's what's going on, right? Now, what I want you all to do, because you know when you change your life around, and this is what happens with me. When I stopped drinking and I stopped smoking and doing some of the things I was doing and stopped hanging around the people I was hanging around, right? What started to happen in the world was that they started calling me back. All that temptation, devil started flirting with me, talking about come on back, right? So what used to happen used to be loud, like really loud. And if you're not focused on Jesus and you start focusing on the circumstances and your sins, it'll trip you up. So right now, what I want y'all to do is, I want y'all to try to get Hogan's attention while we run this race. I want y'all to go, hey, Hogan, okay? All right, and start. Don't worry about it. You follow me. You follow Jesus. Come on. We coming this way. Don't you look at them. Don't look at them. You follow me. Don't you look at them. You good. You come on through. Don't you look at them. Come on. You ain't got to worry about it. Don't keep your eyes on them. Don't you keep your eyes on them. What you doing? Okay, come through here. Come on. Stay right there. Now, you see what happened when he was running with Jesus? He didn't focus on anybody. He didn't focus on the circumstances. He didn't focus on the sin.
You almost got me.
Now, check it out. Now, what I want you to do, you can do that race by yourself, right?
Yeah.
You can do that race by yourself?
Yeah.
It's all good. Okay, so I want you to start over here. Okay, but this time, Hogan, when everybody's yelling at you, I want you to respond back to them. I want you to talk to them, respond back to them, okay? All right, cool. I'm going to tell you when to go. All right? And go. Hey, Hogan, you at the door? Hogan, what's happening? What's wrong with the door? What's going on? Hogan, now stay right there, Hogan. You can stop. Stay right there, Hogan. Don't come out. What just happened to Hogan? When he put his eyes on the devil, it slowed him down. Slowed him down. See, Jesus will have you get past your enemies at the right time. Slow your enemies down. But when you start focusing on your enemies, you get slowed down. And doors that's supposed to be open are now closed. It's crazy. Then, I'm going to come get you, Hogan. I ain't leaving you back there. But see, God's grace, though. See, when you run with God, there's a lot of grace. God's grace is amazing. See, go to 2 Timothy, 2nd chapter, verse 1 in the New Living Translation. I got you, Hogan. Just stay there with me. Now, it says, Timothy, my dear son, be strong through the grace that God gives you in Christ Jesus. You have heard me teach things that have been confirmed by many reliable witnesses. Now teach these truths to other trustworthy people who will be able to pass them on to others. Endure suffering along with me as a good soldier of Christ. Soldiers don't get tied up in the affairs of civilian life, for then they cannot please the officer who enlisted them. And athletes cannot win the prize. See, we was trying to win the race, right? Athletes cannot win the prize unless they follow the rules. If you're going to live this life, you got to follow the rules, y'all. You got to do it. Whatever God says you got to do, just do it. Just do it. That's all it is. So, you know, when I turned to God and I put away my evil ways and I was in ruins and things started going on, man. I mean, it was times when I felt like I lost it all, you know? But then, here's the thing about grace. When you don't run a race the right way, what starts to happen is that all of a sudden, God will get you and open up that door for you. Come on out here, Hogan. Come on out. Amen. Now, it took him a little bit more time, but he still gets to his destination because of God's grace. Because God loves you. You can sit down. Thank you, Ron. Turn to Romans for me. Romans 5, chapter 1 through 6. Therefore, since we have been made right in God's sight by faith, we have peace with God because of what Jesus Christ, our Lord, has done for us. Because of our faith, Christ has brought us into this place of undeserved privilege where we now stand. And we confidently and joyfully look forward to sharing God's glory. We can rejoice, too, when we run into problems and trials, for we know that they help us develop endurance. And endurance develops strength of character, and character strengthens our confident hope of salvation. And this hope will not lead to disappointment, no, for we know how dearly God loves us because he has given us the Holy Spirit to fill our hearts with love. When we're utterly helpless, Christ came at just the right time and died for our sins. God is always with you. He's with you. If you want to win in life and you want to be successful, and if you want to win at this thing, you need to have Jesus with you all the time. Say, I want Jesus with me all the time. That's right. Now, I want to do one other scripture. Isaiah 40, 31, New Living Translation. But those who trust in the Lord will find new strength. They will soar high on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not faint. You know, stuff comes up in your life and you feel like, man, I just want to give up. I don't want to do this no more. But see, God, I like it when in the Bible when it says, but God, it's always something special about to happen. Right? But God, he'll change everything around and make you happy, put a smile on your face. Now, 1 Corinthians 9, 24 through 25. Don't you realize that in a race, everyone runs, but only one person gets the prize? So run to win. Run to win. See, all athletes are disciplined in their training. They do it to win a prize that will soon fade away. But we do it. Christians, we do it for that eternal prize. That eternal prize. See, our prize is up in heaven, y'all. It's in heaven. That eternal prize. Now, when you're running a race and you're running for Team Jesus, right? God does something else. You've won a couple of races. You've been doing good, right? Then he goes, well, I got some other Christians that are running a race too, and they've won a few races. I want to put you in a relay race. Y'all know what a relay race is? When you run around with the baton, pass it to someone else. And when you look at that in the spiritual realm, It's like you're passing that blessing on. You're passing it to that other person. Usain Bolt, y'all know him? One of the greatest, you know, runners, track and field runners ever, right? Amazing. He mentioned something on some tips about running, and he said, you got to get off the blocks quickly. Now, the blocks, you've seen the blocks. When they about to run, they put their feet. They go like this. They put their feet on those blocks, right? And get off the blocks quickly. Now, when you look at that in your life, blocks. Certain things that block you from getting to that opportunity. Certain things that block you from getting to the other side. Certain things that block you from getting that house that you wanted, the wife that you wanted, the things that block you. Get off that quickly. Don't even worry about it. Leave it alone. And you start running. You start running, right? Now, sometimes you're not at the start. You said, God, I've been faithful. I've been doing my thing. Then all of a sudden, you at the stop. You're the second runner. You're looking back. You've seen all these blessings, seeing that blessing in front of you. But why are you not moving? What's going on? But you got to understand that you're part of a team working together. And some people, they can't work together. You know, if you're a racer and you were running alone and God said, now I want you to help others, it feels uncomfortable to some people, right? It's like, I'm cool, me doing my thing, going to church, but you want me to help in the ministry? I ain't gonna do that. I wanna help with others. Like with me, see, God's grace. When I grew up in Chicago, I don't know about y'all if y'all know about Chicago, but where I grew up in the Chi, it was a lot going on as far as gang violence and things that went on. And I remember me and my friends, we went up on some kids, and they was having a gang meeting, some young adults. And as dumb, ignorant kids we were at that time, we decided to throw up some gang signs from the opposing gang just to see what would happen. I was a kid, ignorant, threw it up. Hey, I ain't gonna throw it up now, but threw it up. They shot at us, straight up. Shot at us. We went running, didn't hit us. Hit a garbage. But I could have been out of here just then, at that moment. But I had people praying me through that was running in the relay race with me. See what I'm saying? People praying me through. And when that happened, I started seeing more and more violence and things like that. But then my mama, they kept me in the church, my dad, and they said, okay, Kel, we want you to start acting. Taking classes. I started taking acting classes, and you know, I started doing that. And I told my friends, I said, hey, yo, y'all need to come see me act in theater. And they said, acting is for punks. That's stupid. You in theater trying to do something, man, you need to get on this block with us, right? So I would go. They actually came. I was excited, like, oh, they up in here. They came up in there loud. I'm in theater. It's drama. They like, look at Kel, he looks stupid. He dumb. He trying to act. I'm sitting there. It's a dramatic moment. I'm up there with the spotlight. They like, boo, you suck, right? In the play. I was embarrassed. I cried. I went in the back, cried. I said, I ain't going to act no more. My homies think I'm whack, right? But if I would have gave up, wouldn't have been any Good Burger, Keenan and Kel, all that stuff. God kept me through it. Went on auditions, got doors slammed in my face. Bow. Your gap too big. Bow. Just keeping it 100 with you. You doing a cereal commercial and the cereal go through your gap, damn, won't you? Just keeping it 100. But I said, I'm going to keep going, mama. I'm going to get me a commercial. Y'all laughing at my gap? But you know what? I got on the back of the Crunchberries box. I did. It's one of my first gigs on the back of Crunchberry box. So kept going. But then God put me up where I had the number one show on television, 90s television show, King and the Kill, Good Burger, big, right? Then all of a sudden, things start to change as you get a little, you know, get a little older, start seeing things behind the scenes, things like that. And we ended the show. Now it was like, what do you do now? You know, it's time to start getting some other gigs. And I had a couple of, you know, movies here and there, things like that, that I started working on. But it was independent movies and things like that. And they weren't hitting the same way that they were. Then I went through a divorce because I already had a real bad marriage already, because I wasn't focused on Jesus at the time that I got married. And I wasn't living for Jesus at the time. So the person I married, we were not equally yoked. So it ended up being the wrong type of marriage. Got a divorce. I had an uncle that was murdered. One of my favorite uncles, but he lived his life on the run because he was dealing with gang violence and drugs, and he would live his life like that. I had another uncle shot in the head, murdered. Then I had a teacher tell me, when I was, you know, trying to get my life right and everything, he told me, he said, you're going to end up just like your uncles. You ain't going to amount to nothing. It's funny how when somebody tell you something negative, you focus on the negative. When I had uncles that were psychologists and doctors, but then these uncles, they just decided to say that was just gonna be me. And I let that mess with me, right? And then so, you know, the show ended, got a divorce, and I remember, man, I've always been the type of person where I never give up. But I got to a point where I was high as a kite in Canada at the top of the Sutton Hotel in Canada. High, ready to jump off the other side of the balcony. Because to me, I felt like game over. I don't want to run this race no more, right? All of a sudden, I heard a voice. And, you know, back then, I wasn't in the church like I am. So I said, I heard this voice that told me, throw that weed away and you run into the bathroom and lock the door. And you stay in there till you sober up. And it was weird because I was like backwards with it. Just went all the way back and I closed the door and I sat there in the bathtub, actually, in the bathroom. And I was working on a project at that time, a light mic too, as a matter of fact. And I went on, nobody knew. Because, you know, sometimes as actors, they say tears of a clown because you don't really know what a lot of people are going through in Hollywood. You don't really know. So I'm up in there making people laugh. And inside it was, man, it was hurting. I needed Christ, y'all. I needed Christ. My grandfather is a pastor. And I always known God. But having a relationship with God is a whole different type of thing. Whole different type of thing. So what started to happen with me, man, it's like, you got to get right, Kel. So I had my divorce, things going on, and she taking the kids, and I can't see the kids, and going through court, and all this crazy stuff going on. And then it was like, well, I still want to act. This is still my dream. So I just started taking odd jobs because I'm a hustler. I'm going to keep doing it. I'm going to keep going. I was taking all kinds of jobs trying to make it. Man, I remember when the day that I said, I'm going to give my life to Christ, I met this evangelist, and she said, we're going to pray every day. We're going to pray every day till you get right. Because I was in some wild places. The Good Burger guy was sitting here at clubs doing appearances where the dude at the end was sniffing coke, giving you the money afterwards. And I had to chase people down for checks, running around here with bodyguards and all kind of mess. My life was getting ignorant. Like, it really was. It was getting ignorant. And I got to a point where when I lost everything, and I had no car, I had a little small apartment. And it's funny because my dad called the small apartment, he called it the prayer cave. Because wasn't nothing in there, so it looked like a little cave. And I remember I was up in there, and I would pray with this evangelist every morning. And all of a sudden, years had, you know, passed, and I started living my life right, going to church. And I wanted to find the right church. Then I found Spirit Food Christian Center, right? And at that time, see, you might think, oh, man, that's a horrible story. That's wild. But in that time where I was fixing myself up. Now, remember I told you about when you're running a race, you got to get ready for it. And what happens is that when you're trying to grow your muscles get broken down for it to grow. Well, he does the same thing with your Christian life. Sometimes God got to break us down to have us grow. It's the same thing, right? So now I'm growing in my faith. I'm growing. And I said, I wasn't never going to get married again. I got into all kind of relationships afterwards. I ain't getting married with different women. And, you know, they say it's green on the side. No, it was crazy women, just crazy. I thought the relationship I was in was crazy. It was crazier. Crazy women. I mean, I'm for real. Women with roots and do crazy stuff. Oh, yeah. Ignorant stuff. So, anyway. But when I said it's just me and I'm going to be with the Lord and I'm going to love Jesus, God sent me, man, beautiful woman. And Christ, and that's Asia right there. Beautiful. Now, y'all might say, oh, y'all always been in church. Y'all always been. No. Uh-uh. We was wilding. We was drinking. We was wilding. We was going to the club, all that type of stuff. You know what I mean? Same thing. But God was working on us. God was working on us. I remember one time, it's cool, baby, we'll talk about it. Okay. One time, y'all, we was sitting there. We was like, man, what we gonna do for dinner? And we was eating Little Caesar's pizza. You know them $5 pizza. We was eating them joints like every day. That was it. That was groceries. That was it. We was, you know, and pizza messing with you, get you all big in this pizza. We was messed up, right? We was eating that, but that was feeding us, right? Then. But we was hustling. We love God. We were praying every day. Things going to change around. It's going to change around. And I was listening to pastors' teachings, and I started to appreciate the small blessings. Because sometimes when you all the way up here, and God go, boop, right? He wants you to learn a little something, right? Learn a little something. Now, a lot of people give up when they come right here. They give up. I don't want to run with God no more. I hate it. I don't want to go to church. I hate that. Why would he put me in this situation? And then remember I told you about the relay. What he started to do was, Kel, I want you to start speak to youth. I want you to speak to youth, and I want you to go talk to them. I want you to go to group homes and speak to the kids. Man, I went to this one group home. They was yelling at the officers and everything. And then they was like, what's up, homie? What's up? And then they said, and now we have Kel. And I was like, yo, what am I going to talk about? I just talked about my life and the blessing that came out of that. A lot of those guys changed their lives around. Me and my wife, we said, okay, look, we want to get back in the community. We started a dance competition show. It started to blow up. And we did it in Compton. All the kids was learning about how to film shows. I remember at the time, and these was, you know, blessings. You know, it wasn't a lot like I was making, but it was a blessing for me. Because I said, this is awesome. I'm helping others. And they're getting rich in his mercy. You know what I mean? It was awesome. And I remember one time, as an actor, you know, sometimes your jobs, when they see you get a little older, they're like, well, we don't know what to put them in. We don't know. I remember I was acting like Michael Jackson. I was an impersonator for Michael Jackson. Hilarious, right? It's embarrassing for me, too. I mean, shout out to Michael. But I don't look like Michael. But I tell you what, they paid me, so I was... Pay me so much, one of the old ladies said, I need you to teach me. I pay you money to teach me how to dance like Michael Jackson. I said, okay, what's your number? Hustling. Because a man got to work. It say that in the Bible. I was out there hustling. I remember I went to go get a regular job, 9 to 5. They told me, you too noticeable. Everybody notice you. So you can't work in sales. Because everybody going, good burger, Kel, you can't do. So now what you do? You know what I'm saying? So I had to hustle other ways, and God, every time God would bring up a blessing, all of a sudden things started happening. People started going, Kel, we want you for this movie. Kel, we want you for this TV show. But why was that happening? Because I was in the family. I was praying every day. I was in the royal family. And so when I was sitting there waiting, trying to get it, you know, hustling, all of a sudden they came with that baton, with that blessing. And I'm running. I'm on the move. On the move, Jack. And these blessings started happening in my life over and over. Like, even for our wedding, we had to believe. For our wedding, we had to believe. So many people put blessings into our wedding. where it was just like we didn't even pay that much money for it all. And it ended up in magazines. They put it in Essence magazine. We right next to everybody else that paid millions of dollars. And we didn't pay nothing. And we're sitting there like, okay. Blessings, y'all. You know, speaking to youth groups, speaking to different places, helping kids get off of drugs, all these different things that are blessings. But I would have never done that when I was here before. I had to break down to be able to do that. You know what I mean? And I understand that. And then what the blessing is, I'm going to wrap up. The blessing is that the way God elevates you. I'm telling you, I got a beautiful marriage. Awesome. You know, the jobs that I started to get was like, wow, directors calling me, hitting me up. Because you got to start walking in faith. Get ready. You got to say in faith what you want. I want big films. I want blockbuster films. I want to star in television shows that are huge. I want to have a big house. I want to do this. Man, we live at the place where we were. It's amazing where we at now. Amazing. And we going to have more. Because we walk in it. Like Anisha said, you got to say, hey, them blessings. You got to walk in it. And then the show that I'm on now, it's crazy because it was the same guy that produced my shows back in the day. And I was done with Nickelodeon. I'm going to just keep it 100. You know what I'm saying? I was at a point where I was just like, I don't want to do that. I want to do like drama. And I want to be dramatic. And drama wasn't working out. And I remember I had a conversation with Derek, right? And I was like, Derek, man, I want to be up in there too. Like, I don't want to drama. And he was like, but God gave you grace to make people laugh. In comedy, he gave you grace. Do that. And that sparked me doing stand-up. See, things just start happening. If I wasn't around there and Derek didn't say that, you know. So I started doing stand-up. Horrible at it in the beginning. I said everything fast because I just wanted to get it over with. If the joke didn't hit, I just went to the next one. I was fast. Some of y'all was there at that first one. Y'all didn't want to tell me, and it's okay. But y'all can tell me now. I was horrible the first time. It's okay. Go ahead. Because church members walked out like, Kel was not funny. I thought, he's so funny in the announcements. This is... But you know, I had to keep going. I had to keep going. I didn't give up. I had to keep going. I remember the one where I was horrible. Kevin Hart came in there. Cat Williams came in there. Dave Chappelle came in there the same night. Yeah, same night. Cat Williams just came in the back and looked at me. He was like, man, Kel, well, you know, at least you had a lot of energy like Wayne Brady. Then he walked off. Kevin just looked at me and said, well, you look good. You know, but I hustled. I said, you know what? I'm going to go to all these clubs, and I'm going to keep going. And I started traveling, doing stand-up, working, working, working. Till now I'm headlining shows. I'm the headliner now. So, and then what happens is when you start humbling yourself, and helping others, and telling your story, and not feeling bad about it, and telling the testimony, what starts to happen is God starts to elevate you bigger than what you were, right? And the same guys that didn't end well over at Nickelodeon, I auditioned for a role. Now, part of me would go, well, I got to audition. They know who I am. What am I auditioning for? They know what I could do, right? You know about it. Some actors in the building. They know what I could do. But I said, you know what? I'm going to humble myself, and I'm going to go in there, and I'm on audition. I auditioned, got the role, and what was funny is that all the roles I started to book after this, I did The Game and other shows, people that knew me in the past would go, yo, bro, I remember Brandy when I was on The Game. She said, something different about you. And when we was kids, something different, man. Like, you really different. And I told her. She said, that's what it is. You living for Christ now. That's what it is. That's crazy. And then on set, I started just talking about my love for Christ. I went on set with a purpose to see who did I need to pray with on set? Who did I need to pray for on set? Now, when your mission is that on set, then you're really not thinking about, am I going to make it? Do they think I'm funny? Am I? You got a whole nother mission because you're running a different type of race. Different type of race. That's what it was all about for me. And I was seeing my friends dying. A lot of actors are killing themselves over this stuff. You know what I mean? Because they trying to find something, and they're trying to find what they used to have, and it's Christ. That's what they need. And it ain't even about when you're an actor. It's if you want that promotion or if you want to go to that next level, you need to get with Christ. You need to get in the church. You need to get in the helps ministry. Helping. I love helping this man. I love helping his wife. Do it. Because when you get in helps ministry, it changes your whole life around. When I, man, doing these announcements, even when I'm flying somewhere and I'm out of town, I'm editing the announcements. Still, because I could go, well, I got a TV show now. I'm back. I'm yay. Forget church. He got me back. I'm chilling. A lot of people do that. You see them up at church, they get a blessing, then they leave. Let about 6-7 months go by, they come back. Oh, ain't working like I thought. This show got canceled. My boss fired me. He don't like me. Then they back up here again. If you just stay with it and follow the rules like an athlete, you good. And I'm going to wrap it up with this. What's crazy is that all them years and doing those things, to be back at the same network, and we just found out we're the number one kids show over Disney, over Cartoon Network in the world. Bananas. Bananas. Follow Christ, y'all. It's real. Listen to the word of God. Be mindful to the word of God. Love God because he loves you. And like Anisha said, walk around happy. Know that you're going to get those blessings. Know that it's going to happen for you. And under the stuff that I'm telling you, it didn't happen overnight. It takes time. But my time might not be your time. It might happen a little quicker. It might be overnight. You never know, but you got to be in church to find that out. I love y'all, Spirit Food. So at this time, y'all, this was important because we've both been up here talking about Jesus. We've both been up here talking about Christ. If you have a need right now, you need to come and give your life to Christ, y'all. Can we?
Salvation is the free gift that the Lord offers anyone who would believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible says in Romans 10:9-10 that with our hearts we believe unto righteousness, and with our mouth confession is made unto salvation. I trust that you will believe God's word, that your faith will be in the risen Savior who came to give his life for you. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Will you pray with me this prayer of salvation? It's not difficult. It's very easy, but you must mean it from your heart. So repeat these words after me. Jesus, I confess you as my Savior and my Lord. I believe in my heart that God raised you from the dead. With my mouth, I confess you and I receive you as my Savior. Jesus, thank you for making my heart your home. Thank you for living in me. God the Father is now my Father, and the Holy Spirit has done a work in me. I am a new creature in Christ Jesus, my Lord. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. And thank you for guiding my life. In Jesus' name, amen. We're here to be a blessing to you at Spirit Food Christian Center. The way this broadcast is brought to you is by people's faithful sowing and reaping as a result of God's word being given unto them. So I want to encourage you, be a part of this ministry of sowing and reaping. The Bible says, whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. In this ministry, we believe that man must hear the word of God. For man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. The Bible declares, God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that you always have all sufficiency in all things, may abound to every good work. God loves a cheerful and hilarious giver. I encourage you, be a part of this ministry. Be hilarious in your giving and watch the Lord bring it back to you in many, many ways. In Jesus' name.
You have been watching the Spirit Food Christian Center Worldwide Webcast online at www.myspiritfood.com. Join us for worship service each Sunday at 9:30 a.m. And be sure to check out our website for our weekly live broadcast and much, much more. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good.